Hi folks, hope you're okay today. It's good to be with you and love to everybody out there. My name is Jason and we're having a sermon and I hope it's a blessing to you. If you turn to your Bibles, if you have a Bible or if you could get a Bible, please turn to Romans chapter 12 verse 2. Romans chapter 12 verse 2. Romans 12 verse 2. Let us pray. Father God, we come before you today. We thank you for your love and your concern and your care and your blessings, O God. As we bow before you, we pray in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ that you might be pleased, Lord, to encourage us through your word, speak to us, convict us, restore us, draw us closer to you. Bless us, Father, each one. In Jesus' name, fill us afresh today with your Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. So if you'd like to turn to your Bible, Romans chapter 12, verse 2. And be not conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is the good and acceptable and perfect will of God. The mind is so important in making decisions. If we don't make a decision with our mind, we'll be indecisive and we won't do anything. And the psalmist here is saying that we need to move forward, and we move forward by thinking aright. But we have to move forward. If you turn to Psalm 1 verse 2, Psalm 1 verse 2, we read these words. It says, but his delight is in the law of the Lord, and in his law doth he, what? Meditate day and night. The psalmist is saying he'll go forward in godliness as he meditates day and night on the word of God. That meditation is the mind focusing on the meditating of the word of God. Psalm 104, verse 34. Psalm 104, verse 34. Psalm 104 verse 34. My meditation of him shall be sweet. I will be glad in the Lord. My meditation will be sweet. He's meditating on the word of God. He's meditating on the truths of God. He's meditating. His mind is focused on the truth, the word of God. And so when it says in Romans chapter 12, verse 2, and be not conformed to this world, but by the transformation, by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is the good and acceptable and perfect will of God, we need to meditate on the word of God. I remember, first point, I remember when I was a young boy and I went to swim in the canal. As I swam in the canal, I looked up and I saw a lorry driving over a bridge, and it was my dad. My dad saw me in the canal, and when I got home, he told me off that I should not have done that because it was dangerous. You could die swimming in the canal because of the undercurrents. You know, did you have this canal, but it went into a great big lake and it was dangerous. And so God is warning us when he says, and be not, in Romans 12 verse 2, and be not conformed to this world. But when God uses and be not, he's warning us that this is a dangerous path to go down. God is warning us. In Exodus, Deuteronomy 18, verse 9. Deuteronomy Deuteronomy 18, verse 9 to 14. When thou art come into the land which the Lord thy God giveth thee, thou shalt not learn to do after the abomination of those nations. Thou shalt not. Verse 10. There shall not be found among you anyone that maketh his son or daughter to pass through the fire at the user's divination, or an observation of times, or an enchanter, or a witch, or a charmer, or a consulter with familiar spirits. For all that do such things are an abomination unto the Lord. But you shall not. It's dangerous. Don't go down this way. And so he says, and be not conformed to this world. Don't go down this path. There's a warning. Imagine you're driving your car and the red light came on and you just drove through it. You ignored it. Every time you came to a light, you just ignored it. You're putting yourself in danger. And when you ignore the warnings of God, you put yourself in danger. Galatians chapter 5, verse 19. Galatians chapter 5. Galatians chapter 5. Verse 19 to 21. Now the works of the flesh are manifest, which are these: adultery, fornication, uncleanness, lasciviousness, idolatry, witchcraft, hatred, variance, emulations, wrath, strife, sedition, and heresies, envyings, murders, drunkenness, revelings, and such like, of which I tell you before, as I also tell you in times past, that they which do such things shall not inherit the kingdom of God. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, meekness, goodness, faith, meekness, temperance. Against such there is no law. They that are in Christ have crucified the flesh with the affections and lust. If we live in the Spirit, let us walk in the Spirit. So Paul is warning us not to live in things that are ungodly. And so God is warning us in Romans 12 verse 2, and be not conformed to this world. The word be not is a warning. Take heed. Prick your ears up. We're going to look at transformation. And that's the title of the sermon, Transformation. And what we've looked at here is a warning about false transformation, that there is a warning to not go down a path that is not going to be good for your transformation. And now we're just going to look specifically, what is wrong transformation? Verse 2, and be not conformed to this world. Be not conformed to this world. The Greek is the patterns of this world. The patterns of this world. It's kind of like a couple of ducks that they go flying over the sea, and then they fall into the sea, into an oil slick in the sea, and they get all the oil slick all over them, and they're washed on the beach, and they're just soaked in the oil, and they're finished. And so when it says, be not conformed to this world, it's saying, don't get soaked into it and immersed into it, that it becomes part of you. You're not to conform to it. In John 7, verse 7, the world hates the Lord. So why would you want to be conformed to the world if the world hates the Lord? In Galatians 1, verse 4, it says, this present evil world, why would you want to go back to the world when the world is stated as evil? 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 4, it says the world is captured by the devil. Why would you want to go back to the world when the world is captured by the devil? Why would you want to be captured by the world's ideas? Peter Singer, a professor at Princeton University, was appointed in the 90s at Princeton University as a professor in ethics, and he's a professor now, and he believes that a chicken is more valuable than a Down syndrome baby. Why would you want to be conformed to such stupid ideas as that, or worldly thinking as that? Do not be conformed to this world. If you're in a boat and it's leaking, you need to plug the leak. And if the world is seeping into your mind and heart, you need to plug the gap. You need to not let the world squeeze you into its mold. If you turn to 1 Peter chapter 1, 1 Peter chapter 1, again, get your Bible out, please. 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 14. 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 14 to 18. As obedient children, not fashioning yourselves according to the form of lust in your ignorance. Notice, as obedient children, not fashioning yourselves. That's the same kind of Greek word as be not conformed to the world. As obedient children, not fashioning yourselves according to the form of lust in your ignorance. Don't go down the world's ways, the world's thinking. Verse 15. But as he which has called you is holy, be ye holy in all manner of conversation, because it is written, be ye holy, for I am holy. And if you call on the Father, who without respect to persons judgeth according to every man's work, pass the time of your sojourning here in fear. For as much as you know that you were not redeemed with corruptible things of silver and gold from your vain conversation received by traditions of your fathers, but with the precious blood of Christ, as of lamb without blemish and without spot. In other words, don't fashion yourself to the lust of this world, but remember that you were redeemed by the blood of Christ and go forward in him. 1 John chapter 2, 1 John chapter 2, 1 John chapter 2, 1 John chapter 2, verse 15 and 17. Love not the world, neither the things that are in the world. If any man love the world, the love of the Father is not in him. So don't love the world, or the pride of life. Verse 16. For all that's in the world, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life is not the Father, but is of the world. And the world passeth away, and the lust thereof, but he that doeth the will of the Lord abideth forever. So the world's principles, the world's mentality will pass away, but God's word will not pass away. So be not conformed to the world. That is wrong transformation. If you go down the world's path, it is a wrong way to be transformed. You'll be transformed into something that's not good. But what is right transformation? The Greek in Romans 12, Romans 12, 2, it says, and be not conformed to this world, but be transformed by what? The renewing of your mind. But be transformed by the renewing of your mind. What does it mean, the word transformed? It means a total change. It means like a caterpillar becoming a butterfly, a total change. The word transformation is used, same word as in Matthew 17, 2. For the transfiguration. Matthew 17, 2. Matthew 17, verse 2 says, and was transfigured before them, and his face did shine as the sun, and the raiment was white as the light. Here's the Lord, and he's transfigured. And the same word transfigured is the same Greek word where it says, and be transformed by the renewing of your mind. And transformed means totally changed. And here it says, and was transfigured. The Lord, when it says transfigured in this context, suddenly the glory, the Shekinah glory of God was descending in a way that was just transforming him. A display of his glory. So when it says in Romans 12, verse 2, and be not transformed to the renewing of your mind, it's saying you're going to be changed from glory to glory. 2 Corinthians 4, 16. 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 For which cause we faint not, but though our outward man perish, yet the inward man is renewed day by day. The inward man is renewed day by day. That is what it is to be transformed by the renewing of your mind. You're being transformed. You're being a new creature, and you're being transformed from glory to glory. 2 Corinthians 5:17, it says you're a new creature in Christ. in Ephesians 4:22. Have you got to Ephesians 4:22? Ephesians 4:22. Ephesians 4:22 says that you put off concerning the former conversation the old man, which is corrupt according to the deceitful lust, and be renewed in the spirit of your mind. You put off the old self and you're renewed in the spirit of your mind in the new person. And if you read Ephesians 4:22-32 and meditate on that this week, Ephesians 4:22-32. It's like one minute you go to bed at night, you're poor, and the next day you wake up in the morning and you've inherited £1 billion. One minute you were poor, now you're rich. When it says be transformed by the renewing of your mind, it's saying, look, you lived in such a despicable way. You were walking dead, man. You were spiritually dead. There was nothing about you for God. But now you're a new creature in Christ. So walk in that. Go from glory to glory in that. Colossians 1:21. Colossians 1:21. Colossians 1:21. And you that were sometimes alienated, enemies in your mind by wicked works, you now have been reconciled in the body of his flesh through death, to present you holy and unblameable and reprovable in his sight. So you have been redeemed and reconciled with him so that he can present you before him. So when it says be transformed by the renewing of your mind, these are the truths that you need to be thinking about to go forward. So how do we get transformed? How do we move from being a caterpillar to a butterfly, spiritually speaking? How do we do that? Well, let's go to verse 2 again. Romans 12, verse 2. Be not conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is the good and acceptable and perfect will of God. Notice, and be by the renewing of your mind. The renewing of your mind. I could say, I feel like I'm a chicken. I feel like I'm a girl. I feel like this. I feel like that. Feelings are not to be the foundation of our life. It says, and be transformed by the renewing of your mind. It doesn't say, and be transformed by the renewing of your feelings. It says, and be transformed by the renewing of your mind. You might say, well, Jay, I want to find out how it works. I'll do what needs to work, and that's how I'll be transformed. No, it says, and be transformed by the renewing of your mind first. One writer, Zook, says, God is never against the principle of feeling and doing. He is a God of powerful, passionate feeling, and he commands us to be doers, yet feeling and doing are completely insufficient foundations for the Christian life. The first question cannot be, how do I feel? What do I do? Rather must be, what is true here? What does God say in his word? It's not how I feel, first of all, it's what is the truth. What is it according to the word of God? The mind here is the rational part. The mind needs to be affixed upon the truths of God, upon the word of God. That's what is required. Psalm 19, verse 7. Psalm 19, verse 7 and 11. Says, the law of the Lord is perfect, converting the soul. The testimony of the Lord is sure, making wise the simple. The statutes of the Lord are right, rejoicing the heart. The commandments of the Lord is pure, enlightening the eyes. The fear of the Lord is clean, enduring forever. The judgments of the Lord are true and righteous together. More to be desired are they than gold, yea, than much gold. Sweeter also than honey and the honeycomb. Moreover, by them is thy servant warned, and keeping of them there is great reward. Be transformed by the renewing of your mind means your mind is fixed upon the truths of God, the word of God, meditating on them. That's why it says, by the renewing of your mind, that you may approve what is the good, acceptable and perfect will of God. What is the good, acceptable, perfect will of God? It is the word of God. That is what is good. That is what is perfect. And that is what is acceptable. And it is that what you need to meditate on and appropriate into your psyche and your life. The cults bypass the mind. The cults will love bomb you. The Jehovah's Witness will love bomb you. The Mormons will love bomb you. There are these cults that will love bomb you. They will give you all the love you want, give you what you want emotionally speaking, and they will bypass your mind. We are to meditate on the Word of God. We are not to give up our minds. Our minds are to meditate on the Word of God. Our minds are to meditate on the truth of God. Meditation, says one Puritan writer, will keep your hearts and souls from sinful thoughts. Joshua chapter 1 verse 8. Joshua chapter 1 verse 8. Joshua chapter 1 verse 8. The book of the law shall not depart out of thy mouth, but thou shalt what? Meditate therein day and night, thou mayest obtain or mayest observe to do according to all that is written therein, for then thou shalt make thy way prosperous, and then thou shalt have good success. Why? Because of the meditation. And you can read Psalm 119, verse 47, Psalm 119, verse 48, verse 72, verse 97, 103, all about meditation. Meditate. Be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Meditate on the Word of God. Thomas Manton said, continued meditation brings great profit to the soul. We need to be discerning. There are so many movements today that will try to distract us. But we need to meditate on the truths of God's Word. Philippians chapter 4, verse 8. Philippians 4 verse 8 says, finally, brethren, whatsoever things are true, whatsoever things are honest, whatsoever things are just, whatsoever things are pure, whatsoever things are lovely, whatsoever things are of good report, if there be any virtue and if there be any praise, what? Think on these things. Think on these things. Be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Here, think on these things. Isaiah 26:3. Thou shalt keep him in perfect peace, whose mind is stayed on thee, because he trusteth in thee. As your mind trusts in him, he will keep you in perfect peace. Psalm 63:6. You see, there's a lot of movement out there, a lot of churches out there, a lot of preachers out there that say, bypass the mind. That we need to get in the Spirit and move in the Spirit and walk in the Spirit and bypass the mind. It says, be transformed by the renewing of your mind. That your mind becomes spiritually minded. That your mind meditates on the truths of God. That your mind is focusing on the things of God. By the Holy Spirit. But it is your mind focusing on the truth of God, meditating on the Word of God, on sound teaching. The Bible never anywhere teaches you to bypass the mind. That is dangerous teaching. It is very, very dangerous. And a lot of churches, in order to whip up their churches, to get them in the spirit, as it were, and to move them in the spirit, are trying to get people to bypass the mind. But the Bible never teaches that. The Bible never teaches to bypass the mind. The mind is always to be focused on the truths of Christ, on the Word of God. Psalm 63, verse 6. True spiritual revival, true awakening, means you get two things, spirit and truth. Where the spirit is, there'll be truth. Where there's truth, there'll be the spirit. When people say we're in the spirit, but they don't want truth, that's dangerous. It's really, really dangerous. Because what will happen is the pastor becomes the guru. The pastor or the leaders of the church become the gurus. They're the ones that whip you up into a frenzy. They're the ones that whip the congregation into a frenzy. And everybody's going all into the spirit. And the minds are just being lost in this frenzy. But who's controlling the meeting? It's not the Holy Spirit. It's the gurus. It's the pastors who are conducting and leading the services and whipping people up into a frenzy. When the Holy Spirit's in control, men get out of the way. But today, when the Holy Spirit is supposedly moving, men are in the way. Pastors are in the way. They're controlling and manipulating the services so that people are whipped up and into a frenzy. And that's manipulation. That's of man. When the Spirit of God is moving, get out of the way. Let God have His way. Let the Spirit of God move. Someone might give a prophecy, or someone might speak in a tongue, or someone might share a word, or somebody might sing a song, or the people might sing a song. Who knows? Let the Spirit control the meeting. And wherever the Holy Spirit is, the Word of God will be at the very center of those meetings, and people's minds will be tuned in to the Word of God. Let the Word of God be at the center of the church, and at the center of your ministry, and at the center of your private devotional life. And allow the Spirit of God to use the Word of God. But the moment you say to people, switch off your mind, and just accept the Spirit is here, and go with the Spirit, and switch your mind off, then what you're doing is, you're giving control to the guru, you're giving control to the man, or the woman who is leading the meeting, not the Holy Spirit. And then they can manipulate you, into sexual activity, they can manipulate you into heresies. Why? Because you've switched your mind off. And then you lose discernment because your mind is not fixed on the truth of the Word of God. Be transformed by the renewing of your mind. It's so important. If you want to stay strong in your Christian life, if you want your church to be healthy and strong, then your church has to be a church that is taught to meditate much on the Word of God. Then they gain spiritual muscle where they are able to discern error from truth. And when the Spirit of God is moving, they have the strong ability to discern that it is really of the Spirit, because they are full of the Word of God and they can discern a real movement of the Holy Spirit. But if the people are taught to switch their mind off, when there is a false movement of the Spirit, they have not got the spiritual ability to discern that it is true, that it is false, because they've been taught to switch their mind off, and therefore they have been taught not to meditate much on the Word of God. And so they lose their capacity for discernment. It's so important. It's so important to be transformed by the renewing of your mind, because if you're based on emotion all the time, then you're going to sink, because emotions, by definition, go up and they go down. One minute you're happy, one minute you're not. One minute you're happy, one minute you're not. Emotions go up and down. And if you base your Christian life purely on emotion, you'll go up and down and up and down. But if you base your mind on truth, then you will be stable, because you have a foundation always to hold on to. You have the promises of God to hold on to. You have the truths of God to hold on to. You have the Word of God to hold on to. I'm not saying it's wrong to have emotion. That, like I said in the quote, that God is a passionate God. He is a God of great emotion. He is a God of great emotion. But it is rooted in truth. It is rooted in the mind of the mind meditating on the truth of God and the Word of God. God never goes against His Word. God never moves away from His Word. God never, the Holy Spirit never ever disparages or says that we mustn't listen to the Word or we must switch our mind from the Word. The Holy Spirit never does that. The Holy Spirit always leads us to the Word of God and reveals the Word of God to us. So we must be transformed by the renewing of our mind by meditating much on the Word of God. That is where the real fire comes. That is where stability comes in your ministry. Stability comes in the work. There are churches that whip up people emotionally and they become unstable. There are churches that teach the people the Word of God, but they are moving in the Spirit of God and they are stable. That is what you want for a church, and that is what you want in your own walk with the Lord. Be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Let your mind soak much on the Word of God. So, Psalm 63 verse 6. When I remember thee upon my bed and meditate on thee in the night watches. He meditates in the night. He meditates in the night. Let us meditate on the Word of God much. Thomas Brooks, an old Puritan writer, says, "It is not the bee's touching of the flower that gathers honey, but when abiding for a time upon the flower, that draws out the sweet. It is not he that reads most, but he that meditates most, that will prove the choicest, sweetest, wisest, and strongest Christian." Let us be bees that dwell on the flower, that stay on the flower, and that suck the honey from the flower. And not a bee that just goes to the flower and then moves on quickly. But let us, as bees, dwell and suck the honey of the Word of God through meditation. That is what it means to be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Let us pray. Thank you for listening. Let's pray. Father God, we thank you for this day. Lord, we thank you for the riches of your Word. We are truly rich. We are truly blessed. We are truly blessed by your love, truly blessed by your grace, truly blessed by all your goodness to us. And we pray today, Father, that you might be pleased to help us to meditate much on your Word, that we might be transformed by the renewing of our minds from glory unto glory, that we might love you more, serve you more, and follow you more. Help us, Father. Thank you so much for your goodness and love. In Jesus' name, amen. 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 Thank you for listening. It's been a pleasure to preach the Word of God to you, and I hope that was a blessing to you. Don't forget my website, jasonburnspreacher.com, and from that website, you can get to my Twitter. Every day, or most days, I will put a few verses or pictures or something on there to edify. Then there is Facebook, There are lots of videos on Facebook. There are lots of information, articles and other people's lectures that are quality, and lots of things that will edify you on my Facebook. And then there's this YouTube channel, and then there is the website. And on the website, there's over 100 pages of things that you can look at. There are books that you can download. There's all sorts of things that will edify you and encourage you in your walk with the Lord. If you're seeking the Lord, then you can find something there that will help you to seek Him. So that's from jasonburnspreacher.com. I ask that if you've been blessed by this, to pray for me, support me, and encourage me in serving the Lord. And I hope that this sermon has been a blessing to you. These sermons that you've seen, that you see, have been preached to people live in a little fellowship that we've been praying, and we're still praying about being a church plant, a Presbyterian church plant. We've been praying for a while, but there are people that come every week and they get these sermons and they get these Bible studies. And rather than just put my sermon notes away after studying and preaching these things to people, I've decided to put them on video so that others could get the benefit. And I hope that you've got some benefit out of them. And if you have, I pray that you would pray for me, that God will bless the work that I do, and bear me in your prayers much, please. So thank you for listening, and take care. God bless you.